Coach Gene Carvinger from Millersville and Coach Mike Costa from Cheyney.
Yes, it's good and bad news that you had the biggest run of the season from the punt.
That wasn't all. I thought it was going to be clock. I was just happy to see if we get the first down. Some of our players in the sidelines thought we called it. We did. Well, let me just say this, folks. We're just coming out of losing a three-game skid, coming off a team that was in national championships last year. We have a lot of young people. But I didn't feel we played very well in those three games. But I mentioned this to Coach Costa when I come off. I thought this was the best football team we played so far today. Without a question, the best defense. I never thought anybody could stop our outside there. Nobody. Folks, we ran a wishbone in the second half. There was no way. Our first three stops, the first three times we had the ball, were our outside lead option play with two backs that I think are as fine of backs as there are. And so that we didn't have much of a choice. And there's no question that punt, and I'm happy for that youngster because Steve Miller, who's been with us 4 years, and this is the first year that he's played for us as a punter. Just a good kid, and so I was happy. And there's no question that was great. The thing is, the good is that we won. You know, that's the good thing. The other thing is, the other score that we got was basically set up on a reverse pass, which as Coach Costa knows, and of course even Coach Henson and all the other coaches here, that's not our type of football. So really, two of our scores were provided by unorthodox plays from our philosophy. So and that's a credit to their defense. You know, we could still be playing and be back and forth. We just could not have any success against that front group. I mean, they got some real fine athletes up there. I thought it was just a good, hard, clean-fought football game.
Coach, I got a sense that you wanted to run off at punt formation earlier in the game. Was it something you saw? Eventually, you did run in successfully.
No, honestly, there wasn't anything. A week before against Stroud, we thought we could have done something like that. The only thing that we saw that I thought that the reason, and Coach Al Black, former coach of Coatesville, kind of initiated it, we felt that their defense really pursued so hard that if we could get the action with the lead option going one way, we could come back with that reverse pass to set up our first score. And then we also ran the end around play on the reverse with Chris Palazarski twice for first downs. But quite honestly, they had that punt blocked. Our kid made a great play, and I thought and he was going to his left, and I thought there's no way he's going to be able to kick it not going to his left, and I thought they had it blocked. And then he saw some room there, and he just shot up the sidelines and really made a great run, and good for us and bad for Cheyney. I'll tell you, we didn't see many weaknesses other than what I just indicated with Cheyney's defense. They have great athletes in the secondary. I know they're young in the corners, but they pursued very well. The over-pursued hurt them on those two plays.
Coach Costa, that was about the best 4 quarters Jim Williams has played. It looked like he lost a step there at the end.
No, we've been pushing Jim all week. Came off a decent game last week. We were hoping that we could get a better game out of him. We also explained to him that he had to play a better game against the Millersville club. With the two backs that they have, we feel like we've seen some good backs and played some good people. We knew they were very good backs. So if we stopped their running game, we felt we could stay in the ball. Jim knew what he had to do. He did a good job.
I'd like to add to that Jim Williams story because I thought that when I saw in the film that they had moved him from end to tackle, I thought good for us. I thought good for us. In fact, I mentioned it at my press conference Wednesday, Coach, that I didn't know that was a good move. It seemed like, he just tore us up today. He just tore us up, so I'll take that back on Wednesday. You can rest assured of that. He's a force to be addressed. And I'm sure my linemen and those quarterbacks and that punter knows about it. We couldn't throw anything. We couldn't throw over. He's really, I think the staff here has developed him very nicely. He was just a big kid, I thought, when he came in here. And he's getting better and better. He's going to be awesome.
Coach,
also looked like Malcolm Tate. I talked to him after the game. He said he felt like he was really into the game for one of the first times this season after a couple struggling games.
Yeah. First year, Mel Tate. Well, last week, Mel had a little cold, and it bothered me, so we tried to rest him. And out. We had certain things we saw we could do with his secondary, and we knew with his size and speed that we could substitute him in at tight end sometimes. So we tried to work with that, and it worked out well for us. He's a good athlete. It's just a matter of getting him healthy, getting him involved.
Coach, you threw the ball rather well in spots. Were you surprised at that, or I noticed you? Had you anticipated throwing the ball that well?
Well, that was part of our game plan. We studied the penalties from real hard. We knew that as far as weakness, we thought there was a weakness in the secondary. That's why we spread the people out. If we kept them in tight, they would sit back and pick you off. But if you spread them out, use your lanes, get the seams, we felt we could do a good job. They have a good defensive back, corner back there. Royals, I think, is a very good athlete. He's very smart and heady, so we had to try to stay away from him. But then it was times we weren't isolated, he did it by himself, and put the pressure on
him. And they, incidentally, I think we're last in pass defense in the conference. That's disappointing, too, but part of it has come about the fact that we're so young up front, we're really not getting much rush. I thought we rushed your quarterback pretty well today, and I thought he threw very well. He threw very well, and they beat us deep in our 3-deep coverage zone and ran right by our free safety. Petey King was a junior. Ducky Rouse, our two corners, are both seniors, and that's the strength of our defense, and I think that that's been a disappointment a little bit, but Ducky Rouse is a great athlete. I know going up to Southern Connecticut, he was selected the Division II Player of the Week nationally. He had three interceptions the first ball game, and up at Southern Connecticut, we just had a miserable defensive game, and we scored 41 points, and they scored 43. And so I feel bad for Mike, because I think Mike's done a great job here. This may be the best team that I've faced, although 2 years ago, Mike, in the mud, and really warm, though, wasn't Mike? About froze, coldest day of my life, and I think we won in the early fourth quarter on a field goal, 3-0. Cheyney has come a long way. I've been in this league now 20 years, and they're just doing a nice job and very competitive. And I don't think it's necessarily a rivalry type of game, but it's always a good competitive game. Good, hard-fought, clean football game. How about the ladies? Let the ladies be bashful.
Coach, were you surprised at any time with anything that Millersville did? I mean, other than that, Coach Carpenter already talked about that.
We hadn't seen any type of reverses, but we knew from the past, which I think we looked at the films back from 1960, whatever, on up. Millersville to study to see if we do anything. But as you know, Coach Carpenter's been around a while. And we studied everything, and we had told the gentleman as far as that reverse pass that they were capable of throwing a pass or a halfback pass because Scott Holley can't throw the football also. I think we had that happen to us last year, so we were ready for that. The only thing, a young man, he blew his coverage, and he didn't realize and remember what we said he was supposed to be in, and if he had stayed in his area, probably would have stopped it. But it was a good play and it was called at the right time. Those were the only surprises. Otherwise, we knew what they were going to do and they did it.
Boy, I just can't. I'm still shocked the way they stopped us offensively. I'm just still shocked that this was a tremendous defensive effort by Cheyney. I don't know that we've ever been played that well defensively. I think back in 1970-80, Stroudsburg had a very tough defense. It was kind of embarrassing for us. And we weren't very good then. I don't think we were a very good football team yet. I think we might be an average plus football team. But I really felt going into the season that we had the potential of a better offense than we had last year. For example, in the three games that we just come off losing, we gained more yards offensively than we did when we beat them last year. So what I just said was that the three teams that we lost to, we gained more yards offensively this year than we did last year when we beat them. The difference for us has been turnovers. And I think that may have been a little bit of the difference. Their turnovers were a little bit more convenient area because we had field position early. We tried to play field position with the wind a little bit early, and then they had their turnovers and they were down. They turned us away twice. So when we talk about a team going on a three-game losing scheme, we're down inside their 15-yard line twice in the first quarter with the wind to our back and don't score. So that, and I'm just looking at the stats here, we fumbled twice, and I guess we covered the place. So I don't want to read these stats, but what does it say? About 4-3, that means they fumbled four times and lost three. We fumbled twice and lost twice. So the turnovers were a little bit of a difference, and then we intercepted four. So when you look at this, and I'm sure when Mike looks at this, he had seven turnovers. We had three. Probably therein lies the difference in the football game. And then you take that along, and I'll look at that stuff. You take that along with the fact that two of our scores came on, I don't know the word, Greg, help me, unconventional type of plays. So I have a real concern, but I'd like to leave here thinking that you folks all think that they played pretty well defensively too, Jay.
Dean, let me hear both coaches say just a word about what do you see, what can you say about our conference? What do you see in the future? Just the rest of this season. What do you see about our conference? You probably haven't seen all the teams yet.
Well, I certainly hope that Cheyney wins the rest of their games and we win the rest of ours. Because I think that would be a nice thing. And I really think Cheyney has a chance. I think you beat a team that can get out there and knock some teams off. East Stroudsburg got beat today, and they had beaten us last week.
We beat Stroudsburg.
Bloomsburg beat East Stroudsburg, and they were 0-2 in the conference. So I think see a lot of I see a very balanced conference this year. I kind of picked East Stroudsburg to win. Now, the thing is, the good for us, East Stroudsburg and Westchester both have to play Cheyney. And Westchester has to play Millersville. So I don't think anybody's going to go through this league this year, Andy. This might be the most balanced it's ever been. Somebody usually jumps out, and Stroud would have won today. They've been out there 3-0, and you almost see a lock coming. But with their loss today to Bloomsburg, if that in fact happened, that's what I heard down in the dressing room. You got three or four teams that are 1-1, probably four teams a day that are 1-1 in the conference. I see a great deal of balance in our conference.
But can we handle them guys out of the West this time?
Well, there's no question there is some inequality, I think, in the East and West. The West probably has more money financially than the East does. We were very fortunate last year in the first round of playoffs. Of course, we played in IUP, and probably nobody was more shocked in that game than I was, and we won. And we jumped out with two interceptions by Ducky Rouse, about 14-0. And we kicked the field, but we were in 17-14, though at half. I mean, they come storming back. They are so strong. They're a 1AA type football team. I'm not saying they are a good, solid, clean program. They have more money than most of the other conference schools have. But, I think probably in the Western Conference, in the main, most of those schools have a good bit of money. Now, when I say a good bit, none of them have the 40 equivalencies that you're allowed in Division II. I think this conference plays excellent football for the limited amount of aid that we have. I think probably the team, Indiana, probably has the most equivalencies. Clarion, Edinburgh, and Slippery Rock, I think they're very similar, but they all are in pretty good shape. I just like to say this about our conference. I'm really disappointed in what's happening, that we as athletic directors, not as much athletic directors as presidents, that really haven't taken charge of what needs to be done. We have some isolated cases. For example, Lock Haven, and I'm kind of outspoken, but I've been around and I'm on tenure. So if I think it's terrible that we're in a situation where Lock Haven went down and played Tennessee Tech. No, they switched dates, which should have been a problem there with Indiana wanted another home game, so they made a few grand by Indiana, by them going to Indiana to play. Can you imagine that? So they're 0-5, and they left today to go up to Maine. Actually, they left Thursday to go up and play the University of Maine, who's undefeated, and probably one of the finer Division I AA teams. Then I just found out Friday that we currently have three schools that have already withdrawn from our state game, Westchester, Indiana, and Shippensburg. And there's a good chance now that Clarion's going to, that's a possibility there. And you know, they're scheduling a game with Northern Iowa. Northern Iowa, they came back and played Pitt last year. See, I think that we should be able to solve things ourselves. And I think Cheyney has a great athletic director here too, with Andy Henson, and Andy's a realist.
Dean, let me hear both coaches say just a word about what do you see, what can you say about our conference? What do you see in the future? Well, just the rest of this season. What do you see about our conference? You probably haven't seen all the teams yet.
Well, I certainly hope that Cheyney wins the rest of their games and we win the rest of ours. Because I think that would be a nice thing. And I really think Cheyney has a chance. I think we, you know, you beat a team that can get out there and knock some teams off. East Stroudsburg got beat today, and they had beaten us last week.
We beat Stroud.
Bloomsburg beat East Stroudsburg, and they were 0-2 in the conference. So I think see a lot of, I see a very balanced conference this year. I kind of picked East Stroudsburg to win. Now, the thing is, the good for us, East Stroudsburg and Westchester both have to play Cheyney. And Westchester has to play Millersville. So I don't think anybody's going to go through this league this year, Andy. This might be the most balanced it's ever been. Somebody usually jumps out, and Stroud would have won today. They've been out there 3-0, and you almost see a lock coming. But with their loss today to Bloomsburg, if that in fact happened, that's what I heard down in the dressing room. You know, you got three or four teams that are 1-1, probably four teams today that are 1-1 in the conference. I see a great deal of balance in our conference. And
but can we handle them guys out of the West this time?
Well, there's no question there is some inequality, I think, in the East and West. The West probably has more money financially than the East does. We were very fortunate last year in the first round of playoffs. Of course, we played in IUP, and probably nobody was more shocked in that game than I was, and we won. And we jumped out with two interceptions by Ducky Rouse, about 14-0, and we kicked a field goal. We were winning 17-14, though, at half. I mean, they come storming back. They are so strong. They're a 1AA type football team. They're just, hey, I'm not saying they're a good, solid, clean program. They have more money than most of the other conference schools have. But, you know, I think probably in the Western Conference, in the main, most of those schools have a good bit of money. Now, when I say a good bit, none of them have the 40 equivalencies that you're allowed in Division II. I think this conference plays excellent football for the limited amount of aid that we have. You know, I think probably the team, Indiana, probably has the most equivalencies. Clarion, Edinburgh, and Slippery Rock, I think they're very similar, but they all are in pretty good shape. I just like to say this about our conference. I'm really disappointed in what's happening, that we as athletic directors, not as much athletic directors as presidents, that really haven't taken charge of what needs to be done. We have some isolated cases. For example, Lock Haven, and I'm kind of outspoken, but I've been around and I'm on tenure, so if I think it's terrible that we're in a situation where Lock Haven went down and played Tennessee Tech. You know, they switched dates, which should have been a problem there with Indiana wanted another home game, so they made a few grand by Indiana by them going to Indiana to play. Can you imagine that? So they're 0-5, and they left today to go up to Maine. Actually, they left Thursday to go up and play the University of Maine, who's undefeated, and probably one of the finer Division I AA teams. And I just found out Friday that we currently have three schools that have already withdrawn from our state game, Westchester, Indiana, and Shippensburg. And there's a good chance now that Clarion's going to, that's a possibility there. And you know, they're scheduling a game with Northern Iowa. Northern Iowa, they came back and played Pitt last year. See, I think that we should be able to solve things ourselves, and I think Cheyney has a great athletic director here too, with Andy Henson, and Andy's a realist.
I think that I like now is we do have Millersville behind us. It's a hard team to prepare for.
Feeling mutual.
That option, if you click that option right, it can hurt you. They can do a lot of things off the option. That's why they call it a triple threat. So I'm glad that's behind us. The other people we have to prepare for, they don't do as many things well as Millersville. So I think we stand a good chance defensively. We're not going to let up. We're not going to change. We'll go out and we'll try and compete the best way we can. You're going to have to compete every Saturday. There's no weak system in this conference. Nobody's going to lay down for you. And you just noticed that in Bloomsburg, which was 0-3, whatever, Julius record's 0-2. Go after East Stroud. East Stroud's a tough football team. They're going to come at you and on any Saturday, you know, these young men will get up and you'll play their hardest. A lot of things we have to look at also. We're going away next Saturday. I don't know if it's homecoming or Parents' Day. So special events cause special problems. It'll get up. We'll have an opportunity with Kutztown and we'll really play at home because it's homecoming. So I think we sort of get denied there being that it's homecoming and it's a home game for us. So that gives us a little advantage. And we'll have to face East Stroudsburg and we play them here also.
Kutztown may be beating Westchester 7-7.
Kutztown's beating Westchester.
Maybe. They didn't give, he didn't say he was leading. The score was 17-7, but they gave some statistics, and all the statistics was in Kutztown's favor.
I think
they, Westchester got off a 5-yard punt that hurt him, he said, and a 15-yard punt that hurt him. Kutztown had 9 first downs to Westchester 6. This was the halftime stat. And they had outgunned them passing wise. But then he gave the score and didn't say it would be, but it's 17-7 and a half.
I think another big thing is faced all the schools in Division II. They threw in about 48. That leaves us with a lot of athletes that we can't touch for a year. And then sitting a young man out, it takes time to get it back on track. So I know that you probably have some young men that you could have used this year, just like we have some you could have used. Caliber of athlete that you get is a little different. So you see parity amongst everybody because we all have to go through the same problem. Now we all have to go out and recruit that top athlete as far as being a student. And it's going to help in the long run. Now you don't have a whole lot of people making a lot of mistakes. You'll have a smart athlete.
Coach, I wish both of you would comment. The officiating seems to be getting better, or it seems to be more consistent this year. Have you noticed that? What are your observations?
Mike, you go first.
In some cases, I would say, well, that depends where you play at. In Southern Connecticut, the officiating is terrible. But then we're away, and there were different officials. They were not, say, our officials would think our league. But overall, I find that the officials are a little more concerned about their job because they're a little more caring. They come in and they talk to you, and they seem to be concerned about wanting to do a better job. And they try a little harder. And I think with us being able to rate them and turn in a rating scale every week, that helps to keep them in line. So, you know, the officials are human. You got to realize that. You know, there's times when coaches, they want to just go off and go upside. Officials say, hey, you already know, but they make mistakes sometimes and they can't see everything. You wish they could, because we see a lot of things and they just can't.
Well, I've been kind of pleased with the official from the Mafia. I don't like that name, but I think Middle Atlantic something. I mean, far as signs, and they have them in crews now. So this way you can keep an eyeball on them. I didn't like it. We had this crew last week. We had the same crew today, and I didn't care for that, but I guess that maybe just came with the schedule. But at least we can identify those guys. And I thought there were a couple calls. You know, the thing is, I try to be very fair with those officials. I think they read it, and I sign that, you know. Those officials are going to read. But I rate them every week, Mike. And the thing is, I try to be honest. And at least now they can't hide. When Andy and I were coaching against each other, you'd have this guy here this week with 2 or 5 men. He'd be hiding somewhere else. He might have been a bad official. He's hiding with 4 other guys the next week somewhere else, you know. So this way at least they're together and we can identify the weaker ones in the crew. So I think the crews are working pretty decently. And I think they're basically fair. I think they're basically fair people.
They show a lot more concern than they have in the past. And as you said, with the crews, they want to do.
fairness to our coaches, I would hope we would bring this to a close soon, because they have to get back to the athletes. So we don't want to hang them up too long.
Coach, I really want to commend you guys for this. I think this is classy. This is first class. I realize I'm like, this is Millersville. But, you know, this is really first class, and my hat's off to you. I know you just started something here, and I got a nice note from Andy inviting me to the tailgate party, but I couldn't make that. I felt bad when I snuck them here, and I really apologize to all of you for holding you up here.
Now, this is the day, Gene, that this is the Flynn up sitting in the window.
I saw Mr. Flynn's name mentioned quite a bit in that brochure you sent. Yeah. Is he the one I thought was president?
Yeah.
He said you got new president.
He was just introduced.
And Dr. Hardy.
Dr. Hardy, I thought was impressive.
Department of Science and Mathematics. The two departments sponsor this. What we're going to try to do is encourage other departments to sponsor activities centered around our games.
I think it's a great place. I'm glad the next time I come down here, it's going to be the basketball team. Oh, it's pressure.
Okay, thank you, Jeff.
Thanks.
Thank you guys for coming down. Thank you for coming down.
Thank you. Let's just put it in 30 seconds.